Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Myth of Laziness by Mel Levine, M.D. Read by the author.
The Myth of Sisyphus. In Greek mythology, King Sisyphus of Corinth witnessed Zeus's abduction of Aegina and told her father, the river god Aesopus, who was searching for his lost daughter. Although Sisyphus was merely a bystander, the disclosure angered the other gods, who unjustly condemned him to spend eternity using his hands and his head to roll a mammoth boulder up a mountain in the underworld, repeating the arduous task over and over again. Countless desperate children and adults are the modern-day versions of Sisyphus, as they toil with their hands and their heads, but fail to reach the hoped-for summits of performance in school and in the workplace. And so often they, too, are unjustly accused, in their case, of laziness. They, like Sisyphus, are innocent victims who deserve our sympathy and understanding, for they possess minds that learn and think better than they work. They may radiate brilliance when it comes to logical thinking, humor, and social skills, but what they produce, the effort they put forth, falls short of expectations, the expectations of their parents, their teachers, their bosses. For them, work doesn't work. Like Sisyphus, they feel as if they are getting nowhere as they toil. Their low or non-existent productivity is not their fault, not in the least intentional. Yet like Sisyphus, they are often blamed and even punished for crimes they never committed. Getting a mind to work. Laziness is not an innate trait. We all are born with a drive to produce. We all have within us the resources to be and to feel useful and effective. Most of our own success and that of our children is experienced and demonstrated through accomplishments, the attainments of our heads and our hands. We gain energy and feel good about ourselves whenever our personal output wins the approval, the acceptance, the respect of our friends, our families, our bosses or teachers, and most of all, our own self-critical selves. To feel fulfilled in life, it helps immeasurably if you can take pride in your work. Some individuals somehow, somewhere, lose momentum. In the pursuit of accomplishment, they fail to produce. They stall out. And often, they face accusations of laziness. In truth, through no fault of their own, they suffer from hidden handicaps that disrupt and interrupt their output. They are not lazy. They have output failure. The power and the vulnerability of the drive to be productive are frequently neglected. I believe that adults and children alike feel that a large part of who they are comes from what they do, particularly what they have produced or are producing and what they aspire to achieve in the future. Casualties result when individuals have output failure and come to believe that their work is worthless and perhaps never will be worthy. Our society pays an exorbitant price to restore their mental health, to punish them within our justice system, to deal with their underemployment, and to cope with the many other negative effects of their thwarted drives towards success. Thanks to progress in the neurosciences and related fields, we have learned a great deal about brain wiring, including how, when, and where it operates. As a developmental behavioral pediatrician specializing in learning differences, I have spent 3 decades concentrating on the varied and often subtle breakdowns within a developing brain that trip up basically bright children during their school years. In particular, I have studied the wide spectrum of dysfunctions, the numerous discrete weaknesses that deprive so many students of success. Kids afflicted with these difficulties are the innocent victims of their own wiring. They have specific shortcomings in areas of the mind that control essential aspects of memory, language, attention, motor function, and other processes required for the mastery of school subjects. The gaps in these areas are called neurodevelopmental dysfunctions. Some are inborn, some acquired. Some are mainly genetically caused. Some stem principally from environmental conditions. But most dysfunctions are mysterious, of unknown origin. I have described the wide array of these heartbreaking limitations in my book, A Mind at a Time. Many students wrestle with learning problems that are totally transparent. They manifest obvious trouble becoming good readers, mastering computations and mathematics, succeeding on scholastic aptitude tests, or surviving the social demands of the school day. But there is a substantial group with hidden miswiring, and they have been woefully neglected and misunderstood. These are individuals who struggle with output failure, a phenomenon that can decimate their productivity in school and cause some to fail in the workplace as adults. At first glance, kids and grown-ups with output failure may seem entirely competent, so much so that they tantalize us with their abundant intellectual promise. But then, that promise isn't kept. Often these individuals absorb and process information well. They learn, but they don't produce. They keep promising and intending to do things, but they seldom come through. In many instances, they can read far better than they can write, and they can interpret information, but somehow can't put what they learn to productive use. So their intake greatly exceeds their output, and they disappoint themselves even more than they disappoint others. People say glibly that they are not, quote, living up to their potential, unquote. In the early years of my clinical practice, I was struck by the sizable number of children referred to me who learned more effectively than they worked. I saw a particular concentration of such students cropping up during their middle school years, when there often is a dramatic upsurge in the demands for high output of high quality, particularly in the form of writing. These students had in common their inability to meet the intensified production demands. They became less and less successful in school. In 1981, two of my colleagues and I wrote an article entitled Developmental Failure in School-Age Children for the medical journal Pediatrics. We described a group of students with various forms of output failure. Since then, I have continued to study this too often neglected or misunderstood phenomenon. Output failure is not a distinct syndrome, nor should it be understood as any sort of label or category. It is a result, not a cause. Low output occurs when one or more neurodevelopmental dysfunctions interfere with productivity. This is a very common phenomenon, examples of which include trouble writing a report or difficulty completing a project. Students who manifest output failure are a heterogeneous group. They have a mixed bag of neurodevelopmental dysfunctions and strengths. Some have serious problems getting organized. Others find it too hard to put their thoughts into words. There are those who can't deploy their muscles in a coordinated, efficient manner. Still others lack the mental energy, the stamina needed for output. Some may experience problems remembering, but all of them face one or more high hurdles, stubbornly obstructing their pathways to successful output. For the most part, their actual output barriers are seldom identified and dealt with. Instead, too many of these students stand unjustly accused of laziness or charged with some other form of moral turpitude, and they unfairly assume the blame for their reduced output. Output failure is by no means confined to the first 21 years of life. The condition plagues numerous adults as well, and very commonly leads to chronic career underachievement and gnawing discontent. We all know of individuals who seem competent and well-meaning, but whose productivity in the workplace is inadequate, perhaps even unacceptable. It may be the plumber who took forever and did a shoddy job fixing your bathtub drain, or the accountant who had to keep applying for extensions because he couldn't get to your taxes, or a coworker who triggered bitter resentment because she never accomplished her fair share of the workload. It may be the person who comes up with great ideas, but never carries any of them out. Like students with output failure, the countless adults who cannot seem to get the job done deserve our understanding and our compassion. They are not intentionally turning off their spigots of output. branding them as lazy accomplishes nothing. This audiobook is intended to shed much-needed light on the phenomenon of output failure. As we explore the dysfunctions that result in output failure, we will uncover some of the principal ingredients of successful output. Because I am a pediatrician, and the bulk of my clinical experience has been confined to the 5 to 18-year-old.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.